Why aren't you drinking?
Please stand by for urgent soon. Just to the 2020.
Wrong book, but it's a cool cover.
Oh, just a second. I'm on a different screen. I should, like window these. There we go. It says we're on air, but it doesn't say we're on here. Keep up, it looks. There we go. We are live.
Yay.
Okay, so I'm welcome to Techie Books. This is our third Google Hangout. Today we are talking with Ed Willett, author of Spirit Singer, which will be coming out really soon.
Really soon.
Really soon. So, thank you for coming, and why don't we you give yourself a little history of yourself, and then of the book, and we'll see if any questions come in.
Okay, well, I started writing when I was 11 years old. It was something to do in a rainy afternoon. Is that going far enough back for you?
Sure.
And right from the beginning, I liked to write science fiction and fantasy. I have two older brothers who both read that stuff, and so that's what was around the house, and that got me hooked on it. So when I started writing very young, I wrote all through high school. I wrote fantasy novels in high school and science fiction novels in high school. And I knew I wanted to be a writer, but wasn't sure how well I could, you know, do that right off the bat. So I actually went into journalism to start with. I was a newspaper editor and reporter down in Weyburn, Saskatchewan, which is where we moved to when we came up to Canada from Texas when I was 8 years old. So I grew up in Weyburn, and I went back to work for the Weyburn Review as their, first as a reporter, photographer, and then eventually news editor. And I believe Spirit Singer was actually, I think I started writing it when I was still living in Weyburn. It's hard to remember now because that one, it goes back a ways, that book, and its genesis. But I think it was fairly early on. It was either while I was still in Weyburn or shortly after I moved to Regina, which I did in 1988, to be communications officer for the Saskatchewan Science Center. In 93, I became a full-time freelance writer, but I still didn't have any novels published for a while. I was writing computer books and nonfiction and, you know, anything to make a buck, basically, which is what I still do as a freelance writer. And finally, I had a couple of books published by a really bad publisher that shall remain nameless in the mid-90s, my first couple of novels. And then I had one published by Roussan Publishers in Montreal, which promptly went out of business, although I don't worry, Taiki, I'm sure that had nothing to do with me. Although I have had bad luck with publishers that way, but no, I'm not a jinx, don't worry. So in the about early 2000, 2001, you're just starting to see the first ebook original publishers, the ones who are putting ebooks out and then going to print on demand. And being ahead of the curve, I mean, that's very common now, lots of places, lots of people doing that in various ways. I decided, well, I had this manuscript that it had some good editorial feedback, but it never found a home in its many, many submissions at the time. Well, not that many, because in those days, Harry Potter had not yet created this huge young adult fantasy market that we have now, and it was actually hard to sell YA fantasy at the time. I decided to take the plunge, so I went with a small company called Awestruck eBooks, which brought it out in ebook and then also in print on demand. And being ahead of the curve, it sold, you know, not very much. But I had the book, and I entered it in the Saskatchewan Book Awards, and it actually won the Regina Book Award for Best Book by a Regina Author. And that got it a bit more attention. It has some really nice reviews from fairly substantial reviewing places, you know, like Canadian Literary Review or whatever it's called. Canadian Review of Materials, I think that's what it's called, and places like that. So it got some nice attention. But again, wasn't a particularly great edition of the book. It was very early print-on-demand technology. Cover looks a little pixelated and things like that. And I kept thinking, well, it's won this award. I would love to find it a new home. I never quite did. But then as I became familiar with Taiki Books from going to conventions in Calgary, particularly. I thought, you know, I like the stuff they're doing, I like the people, and I wonder if they would be interested in perhaps bringing out a new edition, and lo and behold, here we are.
There you are. You've actually written a few YA. Do you prefer that over adult, or do you just...
I always thought of myself as a YA writer, and I think it's because I began writing as a teenager, because all of my, well, pre-teenager, all of my books had characters who were teenagers in those days, and somehow, as I got older, I continued to write in that teenage mindset. I don't know, that's just kind of the way it went. And because so many books that I read as a young reader had such a big impact on me, and I see it now with my daughter, who's devouring books and always gets whatever she's reading is the greatest thing she's ever read. I wanted to have that sort of impact on readers, that people would read something by me and say, wow, this is just the greatest thing I've ever read. I just love this. And I hope perhaps some of my books have had that. I've also written, of course, now for quite a few books for adult readers as well. And some of them are kind of crossover because, you know, when your teen readers are reading adult stuff anyway. And my new book that's coming out from my New York publisher, Daw, called Masks, under a pseudonym, E.C. Blake, is kind of a crossover as well. The character is 15 years old, but it's not being published as a YA book, so I don't know what you call that. It is some place I'm very comfortable with writing with young protagonists.
Has your daughter read any of your books, and does she think they are the greatest things?
It's really hard to get her to read my books. I think she's afraid she won't like them, and then she doesn't want to tell me that she doesn't like them, so she thinks the safest thing is just not to read them at all. But she does say she will read Masks when it comes out, and I'm hoping she'll read Spirit Singer when it comes out in this new edition.
Oh, yeah.
She's 11, and she'll be 12, and as she keeps telling me, in 4 days from as we're doing this interview.
So that's actually a good age for this book.
Yeah, I think Spirit Singer, the characters are, I don't remember the exact ages I assigned them, but they're teenagers. But that's what she's reading. She's 12, but she's reading YA books like The Mortal Instruments and like Cassandra Clare. She's reading something now called, I can't remember what it's called, but she loves it. It's the greatest thing she's ever read, although The Mortal Instruments was the greatest thing she'd ever read last week. And of course, Harry Potter remains the greatest thing she's ever read. Everything else gets marked down from there, so... I hope she will read this one.
Yeah, it's always good when you have children who are readers. Because I know we have two, and one devours books, and one never picks up one. So
it's always something that makes them turn on to it. In Alice's case, she didn't like to read when she was really young, and the books that got her going were the Warriors books. I don't know if you're familiar with these, but they're a series of basically adventure. Not really, well, a little bit of fantasy novels, but all the characters are cats. They're like feral cats, and they're real cats, you know, so they hunt prey and all that sort of thing. They're not like, not anthropomorphized in the sense that they're cats that dress up like people or anything like that. And she just loves those books, and those are what, once she started reading through those, and of course I've been reading to her, I still read to her all the time, something in there twigged, and now she's a big reader, and I just wish she'd read my stuff. But I'm sure she will as she gets older. I have a niece who said she doesn't want to read my books because she doesn't want to know what goes on in her uncle's head, which, you know, it's not that frightening in there.
No, actually, your books are relatively tame. I've read some of them, and they don't get real dark like, I don't know, Hunger Games. Mind you, this book's not quite the same age range. But
Masks is considerably more in that direction as far as the... some of the stuff that's dealt with in it, then Spirit Singer is, yeah, for sure. Although Spirit Singer does deal with people dying, you know, and all that sort of thing, but it's not,
it's more of a gentle death. They're not, you know, they die more naturally as opposed to...
There's not a lot of violence in it.
Yeah.
There's some, but not a lot.
I don't have a whole bunch of questions prepared. Isn't that terrible? But I did read the book.
Oh, well, that's good. But I can keep talking. I can tell you a little bit about the book, if that would be...
Yes, definitely talk a little bit about the book. I know you've also done some theater work, and you're big into the cons, because you'll be at Words Collide.
Yeah. I wouldn't say I'm big into the conventions. I go to the ones that are close enough, or that are big enough to justify it. I will definitely be at
When Words. Your autograph can go to Words Collide.
Yes, I will be at When Words Collide. And the interesting thing is I actually have two books that will be kind of launching there. Spirit Singer will be out, but I won't have had a chance to sit at a table and sign books at the publisher's table or anything like that. And I also have a science fiction novel coming out this summer from Bundoran Press called Right to Know, and it will definitely be launching at When Words Collide. So I will be all over the place at When Words Collide, and I've signed up to be on lots of panels. And I like to do the live act. You talked about the performing thing.
Yeah.
I like to do the live action slush,
yes,
where people submit a page of writing anonymously, and then a reader reads it, and then the editors let him read as far as they can before they would stop reading it if somebody had submitted it to them, and they cut you off. It's pretty cruel in a way, but nobody knows who wrote it, so it's okay. And it's a great way to find out what editors, you know, the things that turned editors off. But I like being the reader who reads the slush, and I try to at least present it in the best, you know, voice of God or whatever is appropriate that I can to give it its best foot forward. But I really enjoy doing that, and I'm signed up for at least two sessions as the reader of that, so I'm looking forward to that.
And you've also done Spirit Singer in the audio.
Yeah, so your theater background will help with that. Yeah, there's an audiobook version of it from Iambic Audiobooks, which is available where on Audible and, you know, and at the Iambic, that's iambik.com site. I kind of regret that I chose to narrate it myself. As I was reading through it, I realized that it's very difficult for me to do I can't do a teenage girl voice. Can't even come close. All I can do is kind of lighten it up a little bit, and I think perhaps a female narrator would have been better, because it is all told from Amaranth, that's the main character, it's all told from her point of view. So I think probably a female narrator would have been better. And maybe at some point I'll see if they want to re-record it with a new narrator. I could probably do that. The one reviewer that I read that had listened to it really liked the story, but that was the thing they commented on, and I couldn't really disagree with it.
Yeah. Well, I know we're going into the audiobooks, so we've got male reader too, and talking to a female.
And there's different styles of reading. Sometimes they just read it, and then there's the acting where you actually,
which is always better.
Try to do different voices for all the characters. Yeah, that's it. I realized, having done that, not just on Spirit Singer, but on a couple of other books. Well, just one other novel, I guess I did. I realized what the biggest challenge is keeping the voices straight and. I know that there are other ways to do it, and I think if I do another one, and I hope I will do some more narration at some point, I think a better approach is to do all the lines at once for each character and then assemble it in the editing process, because otherwise you get five chapters through and you last did that voice 300 pages ago, and it's like, what did I do for that? What did I do? And it can be very confusing. Anyway, to go back to Spirit Singer and talk about what it's about and where it came from, I don't know where the idea for it came from. You know, writers always get asked, where did you get your ideas?
And often
I know. Spirit Singer, I can't remember. But basically the concept is that in this world, when people die, their spirits have to be sung from the body, from the corpse, through the between world to the afterlife. And it's like a journey, and they have to be guided by a spirit singer who takes them to the gates of the upper world, and they go through. And the spirit singer comes back to our world. And something's going wrong in that between world. So Amaranth is the daughter of a spirit singer in a small coastal village. Grandfather, I should say. Yeah, granddaughter. He's her grandfather. And something goes wrong during a singing. Her grandfather dies, and she's not a full-fledged spirit singer. She doesn't know how to do what a spirit singer needs to do. And if spirits aren't sung, they wander around and become ghosts. So the village will rapidly become haunted and everybody will be driven away. They can't survive without a spirit singer. So she sets out on a quest in the classic fantasy tradition to find out what's going on and to find a spirit singer or to become one so she could save her village. And she quickly finds out that what's going on in the between world is really quite nasty, and there are some nasty people behind it, and she gets caught up in all this and has to find a way to save her village save her whole society. And along the way, of course, she meets she meets a boy who becomes her companion, and then there's another boy, and then there's some rivalry, and you know, all the classic things are there. it's a fairly traditional fantasy tale, and the way, you know, some of those pieces, but I think some of the ideas behind the spirit singing and so forth maybe, I hope, are fresh.
Do you prefer writing from a female or a male antagonist?
Well, that's interesting. I have done quite a bit of female, although some of them also I alternate. I have a series called Shards of Excalibur, which is in hiatus at the moment because, again, the publisher went away. And I had to get the rights back. But I do have a publisher here in Saskatchewan that may pick that up. It's a modern-day YA set right here in Regina, that hotbed of fantasy, in which the Lady of the Lake shows up in Wascana Lake, downtown Regina, and basically tells this girl, you're now the Lady of the Lake, and you have to find the pieces of the shards of Excalibur before Merlin, who's a bad guy in my telling, can do it. And so that one actually has a female protagonist, but her sidekick, who's not really a sidekick, but that's the way it starts, I alternate between the male and female perspectives in that one, and I've done that in a few others. So if I just go through it, my first novel was called Soul Worm, and that's entirely a female protagonist and viewpoint. The Dark Unicorn, which came after that, was alternated, I think. It's been a long time since I even looked at that one. Andy Nebula, Interstellar Rockstar, was first person male. Then Spirit Singer came after that, and Spirit Singer's female. So I've gone back and forth quite a bit. We got to my adult novels. Lost in Translation from Daw is female. I think it's all female. It's third person, but I think it's all told from Catherine's point of view. No, there's an alien male. That's it. It's a human female and an alien male that goes back and forth in that one. And then we get to Mars Seguro and Terra Insegura from Daw, and they're multiple viewpoints all over the place.
Yeah, I've found those too.
There's a main character who's female, Emily. Masks is going back because it was always intended as a YA book, but now it's grown into a... Look, I have a cover. Can I show a cover? It's not a Taiki book, but this is the cover for Masks. Slightly, look, you can see your reflection in there. It's so
strange.
That's better. Get it out of the eye. There we go. Masks. Oh, or even better. Here's the ARC of it. That's entirely a 15-year-old girl's viewpoint. So, although if it becomes a series, as I really hope it does, she will get older as the series goes along. And then in between there was Magebane, which was written as Lee Arthur Chain, and its multiple viewpoints. But I guess I've done a lot of female characters when I think about it. Yeah, and often be there from their viewpoint.
Have you found now that you have kids, and especially now that they're starting to read the age that you write, that you've changed slightly based on, I know they haven't read any of your books, but I'm sure they said, oh, this is how things should go. Have you found you've done any change in your writing style?
No, I don't think so. Except that, like in Masks, although the character's 15, there's some scenes in the very beginning of it as she's growing up where she's much younger. And my editor, Sheila Gilbert at Daw, said, we could tell you're a father because of the way I wrote these scenes with the little girl and her father. So, you know, when you're writing, everything gets thrown into the mix and you write from everything you've experienced and try to make it as real as you can imagine it to be. I never believe in write what you know. I always believe in write what you can believably imagine or, you know, research and then write about. So I've never been a girl.
That's true.
But I guess I do all right. I haven't had too many complaints that my girls just sound like boys dressed like girls, which is a completely different genre in its own right, I guess.
What's in your glass?
Iced tea.
Okay.
I know it says Guinness, but it's actually iced tea. Guinness is not that color.
No, well, actually, Guinness makes Harp, which is that color.
That is true, but no, that's iced tea.
Sorry.
It's okay. That's something we brought up here from Texas, was our iced tea recipe, which everyone says is the best iced tea they've ever drunk. So.
So you were from Texas?
I was born in Silver City, New Mexico. and which is a silver mining town, a mining town. We were actually living in a little town called Baird, which is a copper mining town in the Rockies, near the foothills of the Rockies, anyway. Then we moved to Texas. I lived in Lubbock for 4 years, and I lived in a little town called Tulia for two, so I'd had three moves already before we moved to Canada.
And was there any weather whiplash between Mexico and Saskatchewan, especially in the winter?
We'd been living in... Lubbock and Tulia are both, you know how Texas is shaped with that square bit on the top?
Yeah, yeah.
That's called the panhandle, as it always is when you have a shape like that and a geographical feature. And Texas, Lubbock and Tulia are both in the panhandle of Texas. And if you look at the map, that's just the southern end of the Great Plains. So it's almost, it's actually a little bit, might even be a little bit east of where, of Regina. But anyway, it's essentially straight up. So you start driving, and the terrain never changes the whole way. It's just Great Plains. And as a result, even though, yes, the summers are hotter and you don't get as much snow in the panhandle, you do get these cold blasts of air that just come down the plains and dump snow, and it can be... We'd seen temperatures of minus 10 Fahrenheit when I was in Texas, and I remember snow up to my knees. Of course, I was 8 years old, so I wouldn't be nearly as deep to me now, but we did get some snow and cold. But yes, it lasted a lot longer up here than it did.
And it gets colder than minus 10 Fahrenheit.
Yes, it was colder, and we were always told that first winter that if you think this is cold, just wait. And then it got to 40 below, and they were still saying it. We decided they were probably pulling our legs at that point. But
yeah.
It did take a little getting used to, but when you're 8, you just accept it. And it's probably harder for my parents because they'd always lived in the South. But yeah, that brought me up here, and I was 8, and then I grew up in Weyburn, which is about 10,000 people. Although my dad was teaching at Western Christian College, and which was then located in the former Commonwealth Air Training Command building. So it was an old Air Force base just outside of Weyburn, 4 miles outside of Weyburn, called North Weyburn, its own little hamlet. So I kind of grew up in the country, but it was like 4 miles from a good size, by Saskatchewan standards, it was a city. And it was kind of an interesting... I would wander around in the countryside, but I wasn't a farm kid, so I don't know what... And I think I always try to put a little bit of Saskatchewan into my books. There isn't actually any in Spirit Singer. Nothing in there that's really Saskatchewan-related, but quite often there is something. So Soul Worm, my first novel, was actually set in Weyburn. Weyburn. And Mage Bane, the Lee Arthur Chain book... is actually set in Saskatchewan, or a place that has the same terrain as Saskatchewan and the same climate as Saskatchewan. The bad guy lives in what is actually the Capel Valley, just outside of Regina here, 50 miles or whatever, 25 miles, something like that. And even there's a town, there's the capital city, has this lake in the middle of it and a big marble palace on one shore. Well, that's the legislative things. Just, oh, from here it's like 3 blocks that away. And one thing about that is, in Magebane, the entire lake is covered by a magical barrier that makes it always spring and never winter. And I did the calculations. If Regina was really the city in Magebane, that magical dome that keeps out winter would cover my house nicely. That may have just been wishful thinking. And sometimes I'll just sneak something in Right to Know, which is coming out in August. It's a hard science fiction, and it's set on a generation starship that arrives at a planet, only to find that in the 400 years that it was traveling at relativistic speeds, 400 years had gone by back on Earth, they developed faster than light travel, had not only gotten leapfrogged ahead of them and colonized this planet, but then lost the ability to travel in space again. So, but in the history that I established there, this faster-than-light drive is called the Umstadt drive. Well, Umstadt is my grandmother's maiden name. And it was developed by researchers at the University of Saskatchewan. So I always like to sneak that in a little bit. There's just something about the word Saskatchewan that's... it seems exotic to people that don't live here, so...
Do you prefer writing fantasies or sci-fi? You sort of seem to have done both, so...
I always thought of myself as a science fiction writer when I was starting, but I always did both. My first book was actually fantasy, my first novel I wrote in high school. It was called The Golden Sword. And years later I revised it and made it The Silver Sword because I realized you couldn't actually lift a sword that was made out of solid gold. And no, it's too soft anyway. So that was fantasy. Then my next one was kind of a weird adventure story called Ship from the Unknown, set in the Amazon rainforest, about which I knew absolutely nothing, and involved helicopter gunships and things like that, about which I knew absolutely nothing. So it was really just an excuse to write action scenes. And then, yeah, so I guess now that I think about it, I mostly wrote fantasy to start with, even though I always thought of myself as a science fiction writer. But the first book I wrote that seriously tried to get published, which I'm going to be bringing out myself because it never did find a home, was science fiction. And I always wanted to be more of a science fiction writer, and now I'm kind of going back and forth. Part of it is because my New York publisher, Daw, after Mars Segura and Terran Segura, which are science fiction, came out, said they wanted me to switch to fantasy. Fantasy sells better, which is how we got to Mage Bane, which was fantasy under a different name, and now E.C. Blake and Masks. So I'm probably going to be writing more fantasy going forward, just because from a marketing point of view, it seems to sell better. But I was very happy that Bundaran, that's how I pronounce it. I don't actually know how to pronounce the name of my own publisher, brought out Right to Know, because I do love being a science fiction writer and not just a fantasy writer. I like to be both. And it's hard to say which I prefer. I think I find writing fantasy a little easier. Science fiction, I'm always much more conscious of getting my science right, obviously, and on fantasy you can explain a lot with magic. So for Right to Know, I was researching starship designs and trying to come up with something that hadn't been done before, and what's the propulsion mechanism and all this sort of thing. Whereas if it's magic, you would just say, you know, you would come up with a consistent magical system, but at the same time you're making it up out of thin air. So. But I suppose from that point of view, it's a little easier to write fantasy.
And when you go to the YA, like Spirit Singers Fantasy, and you've done a few YA sci-fi?
Really just, well, I keep forgetting the books that my own foray into indie publishing, as they say. The Haunted Horn is fantasy, but the other one I did there, The Chosen, is science fiction, also set in Saskatchewan, a post-apocalyptic Saskatchewan. And Andy Nebula, Interstellar Rockstar, was science fiction. So yeah, I guess I have done a couple of YASF, and there's also a sequel to Andy Nebula called Double Trouble, which again, I put out myself, which is science fiction. But now on my YA, like the proposals I've got out there are all fantasy. So YA science fiction is still a harder sell, I think. There are some people doing it now. For a while it was almost, well, my good story there is this first book I tried to publish, which I called Star, it was originally called The Minstrel, now it's called Star Song. And it came out of a short story, which was one of the first short stories I ever sold, which was a science fiction short story to a children's magazine called Jam that doesn't exist anymore. I was sending it around. I sent it to Josepha Sherman, who was then at Walker & Company. And she didn't take it, but she came back and said, you know, I really like this, but I think you need to expand the middle section. If you rewrite it, send it back, I'll take another look. So I rewrote it, and I sent it back, and it came back again. She didn't take it, but I found out at the first World Science Fiction Convention, hey, you've got a black cat, too.
Oh, she's tortoise shell.
Oh, see, my black cat is asleep in the chair back there.
So. Mine was asleep beside me, and she just jumped on.
So at the World Science Fiction Convention in Winnipeg in 1994, which was the first one I'd ever attended, Josepha Sherman, who's passed on since then, was there. And in a panel, she said, she saw me, and she said, I was going to take your book, but the publisher died. His son took over the business, and his son decreed there would be no more science fiction published by Walker & Company. Apparently, he thought that was beneath him somehow. And so that was it, and I've never had... That was my first novel. It was that close to selling, and it never found a home after that. So again, I really started out thinking of myself as a science fiction writer, but I've never been one to draw bright lines between the two. I'm happy to write a Basically, I'm just happy to write. Happy to write, happy to get paid to write, and really happy when people read what I write and enjoy it. That's really the ultimate reward.
So let's go back to some of the theater work you've done, because I know you've done some plays, and if people are in Saskatchewan, do you have anything coming up that they can see?
Actually, I'm not performing anytime soon, but I wrote a play called As Time Goes By, A Love Story with Music and Ghosts. This old house, you can see my office back here, but this house was built in 1926 and belonged to my wife's grandparents. They moved in 1939, and the family has owned the house ever since. And it's really, you can tell by the amount of stuff that has piled up around the house over those decades. And among the things that piled up in the house was music, because Margaret Ann, that's my wife, her grandmother, Nancy Goodfellow, could have had a career as an opera singer. She was very, very talented. And she and they were very involved with various musical things in the city. And she and a friend, Helen Jolly, who was one of the nurses at the General Hospital, would buy the latest sheet music from Hatton's Music, which is a well-known music store that's not there anymore downtown, and bring it to the house and play through it and sing it. And that was, you know, this was probably in the 40s, 50s time frame. And so as a result, we have all this pristine sheet music. Oops, my phone. I'll just let that go. We have all this sheet music. I'll just pull one out at random here, which is in great shape. You know, this kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I actually have that piece.
Oh, do you?
Scary.
And I always wanted to do something with all that music. And this play is actually kind of built around it. So although it's not autobiographical, it does have a fantasy element too. It's about a singer who's had a bit of a career in Toronto. Inherits this old house in Regina that belonged to his great aunt Dorothy, and he comes back and with his piano player, who's just hoping to get paid because he hasn't been for a while, and his manager, who's actually from Regina and is in love with him, but he doesn't realize it, and she's planning to stay in Regina and dump him while she's here. So these are all the sort of the threads. Oh, I better check that. They seem quite insistent.
Okay.
Hold on 1 second. Unknown number. Can't be that important. Okay. Well, that derailed my train of thought quite thoroughly. So, yes, so he inherits this old house, and he comes back and discovers all this old music in the house and this great piano, and he's going to build a new act around the music, which is, this gives us an excuse to sing some of this great music that I found in the house. The fantasy element comes from Great Aunt Dorothy may be dead, but she's still hanging around. And she had her own sort of thwarted love. She was in love with this guy who went off, and I'm going to have to mute this and see what this is all about. Just hold on a second.
Okay. Stand by, folks, while we take a brief break. And I will probably cut this on the YouTube channel. And I feel like I need to do a song and dance.
Okay, I'm back.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. You can't take the phone off the hook because then it beeps. So I don't know what to do. She had her own great love who went off himself to Toronto to become a singer way back when, and basically became quite famous and never came back for her. And he's regretted that. Now he's died and she's died. So we have the ghost part is that the two ghosts get together as well. So it's in kind of classic in musical theater. You have the big romantic couple. Then you have the comic couple, which in this case is the piano player and the real estate lady who's trying to sell the house, but who also wants to be a singer. And then you have the ghost couple. And that's kind of the structure of it. It just gives us, there's 18 songs. I'm directing it. We got a nice city grant for the project, which is nice because it is a local connection. And it goes up the first weekend in November. So if anybody is seeing this in Saskatchewan or is going to be around Regina at that time, please come see it. You can find out more about it at ReginaLyric.com is the website of the Regina Lyric Musical Theatre Company that will be putting it on. Or my website, I'll put stuff up as it gets closer. I should mention my website.
Yes, where can people basically stalk you if they want to?
It's quite easy to stalk me. I'm at edwardwillett.com. That's EDWAIRDWILLETT.com. You can find me on Twitter at EWillett. Again, two T's. It's that second T that gets missed a lot. and I'm also on Facebook. You can find me there. And I'm on Google Plus, although I haven't done too much with it, but you can find me on there as well.
And now you're going to be on YouTube for...
And now I'm going to be on YouTube, and I have my own YouTube channel. I don't put much up there, but I'll certainly make sure this is linked too. So
that's good. Well, I think it's been 40 minutes already, so I think we're going to end it there.
Okay.
Unless there's anything you specifically want to tell the people.
I would just say that Spirit Singer is. I'm very proud of the book. It did win the Regina Book Award at the Saskatchewan Book Awards in 2002, which was special to me because my dad had just passed away the year before that, or not even just a few months before that, which is why you'll see the book is dedicated to him. And I have a soft spot in my heart for it because it did win the award, and I'm just really happy that it's coming out again in a new edition that hopefully will find lots and lots of brand new readers this time around. And it looks like a great cover and a great edition, so I'm really looking forward to seeing it.
Yes. So go out and buy it. Buy lots of copies.
Absolutely.
Buy it at all the normal, Amazon or e-formatted Amazon Kobo iBooks Smashwords.
And buy copies for your friends, too.
Oh, yes. Books make great gifts.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Ed. Next month, we are going to be talking to Kevin Harkness, author of City of Demons, on July 13th. And again, thank you very much.
Thank you for a wonderful interview.
Thank you. And we will talk to you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye.